Well, hey, everybody. So glad that you're here. And if you're just kind of joining us, we want you to know that you're joining us at the front end. You couldn't have picked a better time of a series called The Story, where we're looking at this abridged version of the Bible, New International Version of the Bible, and we're looking at major stories that have taken place from Genesis to Revelation. So we're right at the beginning of it, and it's not too late for you to get involved. We got more of these resources if you need one out at the Source, which is down by door one in our main lobby, and you can get those. Got them for all ages. And I heard this week Eastsiders have bought for themselves or to give away to other people that they care about 8,700 copies of the story. And I'm just like, how does that happen? That's just amazing. So hey, show of hands, how many of you did your homework this week? Read chapter 3? Wow, that's amazing. How many of you just blew it off and pulled out your old DVD of Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat? Huh? Right there. Boy, and that Donny Osmond, man, he was the man, wasn't he? How many of you 50, 60-year-old women had a crush on Donny Osmond back in the day? Come on, let's see it. Yeah, for those of you under 25, this is like the Justin Bieber of another era. Hey, today I have the privilege of unpacking for you one of the great, great, great stories of the Bible, and I really mean that. And kind of set it up, I've told some of you this before about when we go to Minnesota in the summer, I've got this favorite fishing spot that I like to go to, but it's about 20 miles from where our family has a cabin, and so we have to trailer our fishing boat, and we have to journey about 20 miles, and we have to launch on a lake, but we can't launch on the lake we like to fish on. We have to launch on another lake, and we motor across this first lake, and there's a lot of activity and boats and cabins and people fishing and water skiing and things like that, and wakeboarding. And then we come to a channel. It's about as wide as these aisles here, and there's lily pads on each side and walls of white birch trees, and it's about the length of a football field. But the channel gets shallow, so you have to slow your boat down. And then it gets so shallow, you have to lift your motor a little bit, or your motor will hit on the bottom of the channel, and you kind of putts through the channel. And then it gets shallower yet. You have to lift your motor all the way, and you get out the oars, and you have to row through a little bit of the channel. Then the last 50 feet or so, the bottom starts to hit the bottom of the boat. It's so shallow. And at that point, Barbara and the kids get out and pull me through the last 50 feet or so. No, actually, I get out of the boat. Here's a shot of our son Jeremy and myself going through the channel. There's Jeremy, and I'm up kind of pulling with a rope, pulling Barbara and the girls through, and going out. Now, on the other side of this channel, it opens up to the most beautiful, quiet, little peaceful lake that you can imagine. I've seen deer drink out of the edge of the water, eagles fly overhead, and the fishing is just unbelievable. I mean, we bring them home by the bucket load, kind of from here, and the interesting thing, though, is back on this lake, I've never seen more than three or four boats back there at a time. There's only two cabins on the entire lake. And you say, well, Gene, if that lake over there is so beautiful and if the fishing is so great, why aren't there more people back there? And the answer is very simple. It just takes so much work to get there. You got to trailer your boat. You got to drive 20 miles. You got to launch on another lake. You got to motor across that first lake. You got to come to the channel. You got to slow your boat way down. You got to lift your motor a little bit partway through. Then you got to lift it all, and you got to get out your oars, and you have to row through. Then you have to get out of the boat, and you have to portage the way through. But only those who are willing to go through the adversity of that channel experience the better fishing on the other side. Now, today, I want to talk to those of you who have ever been, maybe you are right now, or will be one day, in the channel of adversity. Remember the day you figured out that life wasn't going to turn out quite like you planned? You know, you had it all dreamed out how it was going to be. You know, it was going to be the perfect house, the perfect spouse, the perfect 2.3 kids, the perfect job. Nobody ever grows up thinking, I'm going to graduate from college and be unemployed. Or I'm going to be alone and depressed at age 30 or divorced twice by 45. Or I'm going to lose my job when I'm 56. Nobody ever thinks we're going to have a special needs child. Nobody ever thinks their son or daughter's going to end up in prison. Well, Joseph's picture of his life is a story of getting through the channel of adversity. And what we see is while Joseph is in this channel of adversity is that there's really two stories going on. There's this lower story that Joseph has experienced of all these difficult things that he goes through. And then there is the upper story that God is writing. And it's an epic story and how it all fits together. Now, if you're just joining us, you're probably going to feel like today you jumped into the middle of a season of Lost or something like that, and you're going to feel completely lost. So let me try to just give you a little quick review of where we've been. In chapter 1, we talked about the story of creation, the beginning of life as we know it. We learned that the world began with God, and he's good, and he created a good world that was very good. And then it all fell apart, and it all broke. And except for one man, we would have been stuck in our broken relationships, in our broken relationship with God, and in our broken families. But because of Noah, because of a man named Noah, God saved the world. One man can save all of mankind, God proved. Then last week in chapter 2, we talked about how God builds a nation. And God built a nation in a very unlikely way. He called an elderly, infertile couple named Abraham and Sarah, and he made 3 promises to them. He said, I'm going to give you a land. And we know, we read through the scripture, that land would become Canaan, or what we know today as Israel and the Palestinian territories. I'm going to take a trip there next spring, if any of you want to join me on that. And then he said, I'm going to make you into a nation. And that nation would become the nation of Israel. And then he said, through you, through your descendants, Abraham, the world is going to receive a great blessing. The entire world will be blessed through you. And of course, we learned that the Messiah, Jesus Christ, who would come from the descendants of Abraham, would be the blessing, the Savior of our world, all world, no matter who people are, no matter what their background is, no matter what their ethnicity is. And so last week we learned that you can sum up the entire story of the Bible in one sentence, and it's how God worked in history to restore the relationship with broken people like us. So let's just say that together, okay? Let's read it out loud. How God worked in history to restore the relationship with broken people like us. So now the question is, how does Joseph fit into this grand story that we're studying? Well, Abraham, who we talked about last week, had a son named Isaac. And Isaac had a son named Jacob. And Jacob had a son named Joseph. You see, God was building a nation through Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. In fact, you'll read 217 times in the Old Testament of the Bible, you'll see this phrase, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So Joseph down here is the son of Jacob, he's the grandson of Isaac, and he's the great-grandson of Abraham, who we studied last week. And as we come to chapter 3 of the story, page 29 in the scripture, and by the way, I just discovered this weekend. For those of you that have downloaded the story on your iPad or your Kindle, and when I say page numbers, I know it's no help to you at all, and I'm sorry about that. But we're going to be on page 29 of chapter 3 of the story. As we get here, Joseph is a teenager, and he's grown up in a relatively dysfunctional family. Joseph is the first son of Jacob's favorite wife. Now, you heard me correct there when I said Jacob's favorite wife. Jacob, his dad, has 4 wives. And Joseph is born to his favorite wife. And so as a result of that, he lives with his mom and 3 stepmoms. I mean, this is sounding like a Disney movie, isn't it? You know, you got the mom, you got the wicked stepmom, you know, and all that. Except in this case, it wasn't the stepmoms that were so wicked. It was his brothers who despised Joseph. And they despised him because he was Daddy Jacob's favorite. And he showed partiality and he showed favoritism. In fact, his dad gave him this beautiful, colorful, full-length, exotic, ornate coat. And that was a problem, showing his favoritism, because in that day there were rules, and the rules was that the oldest son received the birthright, the oldest son received the best, the oldest son received the most, and at this point in the story, Joseph is the youngest son in the family. Not only that, but having this ornate fancy coat meant that he's not going to be working out in the shepherd fields with his brothers. He's management. He's an executive now. He's like in the fifth story penthouse corner office type of thing. Now you tell me how this made Joseph's brothers love and cherish their little brother. Can you imagine Christmas morning, you know, Joseph opens up his Xbox and his iPad and his brothers all open their Chia Pets. And that's kind of how it was. Now, they hated their brother Joseph. And when Joseph is 17, God gives a dream to Joseph. And he dreams that his brothers are stars, and his mom and dad are the sun and the moon, and they all bow down to him. Now, note to self. If you ever have a dream of your brothers and sisters bowing down to you, keep said dream to yourself. Don't share that over Cheerios in the morning, okay? But Joseph tells his brothers about the dream. And so they're sick of him now, and they hold a tribal council, and they vote him off the island. And one of them says, let's kill him. And the other says, that's a great idea. We're down for that. And then later, somebody said, well, rather than kill him, we might as well get something out of him. Why don't we sell him? And so they sell him. Let's make a few bucks. So they grab him, they rough him up, they throw him into a pit. When some Ishmaelites come by, they sell him. Now, just for those of you here last week, does the name Ishmael ring a bell to anybody? Isn't it amazing how these little pieces of the story like when you read them isolated, you don't understand them. You see this, God's writing this big story. So these Ishmaelites come by and they buy him. And his brothers take this beautiful coat, they fill it with goat's blood, they take it back to their dad, they break his heart, and he grieves for his son who he now believes has been killed. At age 17, Joseph has gone from this dreamer with a beautiful coat, and all of a sudden, he's beaten, he's thrown in a cistern, he's sold as a slave, and he ends up working for an Egyptian. You know, those people with the funky eyeliner. But this was not the end of Joseph's channel of adversity. This was just the beginning of 22 years of Hades in his life. Joseph gets to Egypt, and nobody's bowing to him anymore. And if you jump over to page 31, kind of right up towards the top, that second paragraph says, meanwhile, the Midianites sold Joseph in Egypt to Potiphar, one of Pharaoh's officials, the captain of the guard. Now, who's Potiphar? Potiphar was the chief executioner for Pharaoh. And I'm just saying, when you're sold into slavery, the last guy you want buying you is an owner who's in the black hood, right? Here was pampered little Joseph all by himself, and he's doing the work of a slave for Dr. Death now. This is true. But just as you would hope, circumstances begin to turn around for Joseph. You think, isn't this nice? And Potiphar notices how capable Joseph is, and he puts him in charge of all of his household. He doesn't concern himself with anything. He kind of takes early retirement and heads to the golf course or something like that. And now Joseph is running the affairs of Potiphar's household. And you think the story's kind of going to go, and they lived happily ever after. But that's not how the story goes. All of a sudden, the story takes a Jersey Shore-like left turn. Jump down to the below mid-page on page 31, and it says, now Joseph was well-built and handsome. Translated, means he's well-built and handsome. And after a while, his master's wife took notice of Joseph and said, come to bed with me. Now, no doubt, because of Potiphar's position, Lady Potiphar would have been a beautiful kind of trophy wife, okay? So she takes notice of this young, well-built, handsome, ripped, hot young man, and this cougar makes her move on him. And I need to tell you that in the original Hebrew language, this is crass. When she says, come to bed with me, it's not like, hey, baby, what's your sign or something like that. She is like, I mean, they've given it a PG translation here of what she really says. I mean, she's really saying, come on, man, let's just do the nasty. Let's do this thing. It's that kind of vulgar kind of talk. But Joseph says, page 31, down lower in the page, he says, how then could I do such a wicked thing and sin against God? Now, every red-blooded American guy in this room right now is going, wow. Because here's a guy who's been completely screwed over by life. Apparently, he's been screwed over by God, and he's from a dysfunctional family, and he's been a slave, and he's got no opportunity for a normal life, and now Lady Hotness is saying, hey, baby, and he says no. And he doesn't say no because your husband will kill me if he finds out. He doesn't say no because I'm saving myself for marriage. He says no, how could I do such a thing and sin against God? You see, what happens to many of us in life is when we experience disappointment or adversity comes our way, we use that as a ticket for disobedience. Joseph could have justified this and said, you know, hey, I kind of deserve this after all I've been through, what my brother's been through, the slave thing, it's been rough, and now there's somebody beautiful who wants me and thinks I'm wonderful, and everybody else throws me in the pit, but at least this woman wants me. And you justify the ticket to disobedience. You know how this is. You can justify things. You're in McDonald's and they mess up your order and takes them forever to get it all straight. And you're walking out the door and you realize they forgot to charge you. And you think, well, I guess that's just what they deserve. You know, sometimes we use the area of disappointment to justify sin. And I think that's especially true in, like in this circumstance, when it comes to sexual sin. I remember years ago when I was a single bachelor pastor in Las Vegas, as in my late 20s, early 30s, and we did a survey among some single young adults in our church, 33 single young adults, and we asked them, what is the number one temptation that you deal with? And 27 of the 33 said sexual temptation. And being single at the time, I remember thinking to myself, I can't imagine what the other six put. I think they probably should have put lying as their number one temptation. You know, I think there's a tendency for us to feel like, okay, God, if you're not going to come through for me in this area of my life, it means I can just be disobedient in that area of my life and do things my way, not your way. And so a wife can't remember the last time she felt listened to or loved or cherished or that she mattered to her husband, and so she justifies the flirtations at work or the connecting with an old flame on Facebook. Or a husband is married to a wife and she makes intimacy feel like it's just another chore on her to-do list, kind of between the laundry and doing the dishes. And so he justifies logging onto a website because after all, he has needs. Even though Joseph's story is not unfolding how he would have imagined, he still says, how then could I do such a wicked thing and sin against God? Just extraordinary character. One day, Potiphar's wife takes it to another level. She kept, you know, coming after him day after day after day, and her desire builds up to the point she can't stand it anymore. And once again, she says, come to bed with me. And Joseph is so shocked by her aggressiveness, while she's holding on to his coat and grabbing him, come to bed with me, he runs out of his coat, runs out of the house, right into his boxer shorts or something. Now, this is the second coat that he's lost. The guy has trouble holding on to his coats, doesn't he? Well, as Joseph runs to escape the advances of Mrs. Potiphar, she starts screaming, rape. Rape, that boy tried to rape me. And by the time Mr. Potiphar comes home, she's worked up an Oscar-winning performance. She's got the trembling lip thing down. She's got the tears coming down her face. Maybe she's messed up her hair, torn her clothing or something like that. And when Mr. Potiphar finds out, Joseph is thrown in prison for the next 10 years. Now, when I say prison, it's a dungeon. At least initially, it's a hole in the ground where he is chained, and he's done nothing to deserve it. Now, you know, as we go through the story, here's what we're going to find. We're going to find there are many people who go through adversity in their life, and most of the time, it's their own fault. They bring it on themselves. We look at Adam and Eve, and they sinned, and they brought the whole fall of the world and brokenness on themselves. We looked at Abraham and Sarah last week, and they invited the mistress, Hagar, into their marriage, and it created all kinds of problems for them. They brought it on themselves. But Joseph has done nothing to deserve this. It wasn't his sin. It wasn't his disobedience. This didn't happen because of his unfaithfulness. There's a lot of disappointment in his story, but it just feels so unjust because he didn't do anything to deserve it. It was just life. He was a victim of somebody else's decision, somebody else's choice. And he started off with a dream, and he became a slave. What's worse than being a slave? I'll tell you what it is. Being a prisoner. And that's what happens. And at one point during his time in prison, you kind of think, oh, here's the big moment for a new day in his life. The warden soon sees that Joseph is quite capable, just like Potiphar noticed in him, and the warden of the prison puts Joseph in charge of the prison. And there are two prisoners under Joseph. One is the cupbearer to Pharaoh. He's the one, you know, who tastes wine to make sure it hasn't been poisoned or something. And the other is the baker. And they have these really explicit dreams, the cupbearer and the baker. And Joseph is given the interpretation of the dreams by God. And sure enough, one of them gets back to serving Pharaoh, just as Joseph had predicted from the dream. And the other ends up being hanged, just as Joseph had predicted. And Joseph said to the one who ended up serving back Pharaoh, he said, hey, when you get back there to Pharaoh, remember me. Remember me. And you're thinking, yes, this is going to be Joseph's big break. But the Bible says the cupbearer forgot Joseph. And you're like, oh, no. 2 years go by. And Pharaoh had a dream about some skinny cows. And I don't know if they look like this cow here, but they were skinny cows. And the dream was that the skinny cows eat fat cows, and some skinny ears of grain eat some fat ears of grain, and nobody knows how to interpret this, and Pharaoh wants to know what the dream means, and all of a sudden the cupbearer goes, oh, wait a minute, I know a guy who does dreams. And he sends for Joseph, and Joseph interprets Pharaoh's dream. And Joseph told him the dream means that these skinny cows are going to eat some fat cows, and skinny ears of grain are going to eat the fat ears of grain. And what that means is you're going to have 7 years of great prosperity, great time of harvest. And then it's going to be 7 years of famine. So you got to prepare in the 7 years of plenty for the 7 years of famine. And Pharaoh is like, Joseph, you're the man. And he puts him second in charge of Egypt. He is now the vice president of Egypt, the second most powerful person in the world. Page 33, if you want to turn over. About three-fourths of the way down the page. Next to the last paragraph. So Pharaoh said to Joseph, I hereby put you in charge of the whole land of Egypt. Then Pharaoh took his signet ring from his finger and put it on Joseph's finger. Now notice this next phrase. He dressed him in robes of fine linen. Now look at this. He got a new coat. Don't miss that. His brother stripped him of his coat. Potiphar's wife grabbed the coat when he ran out of it. But in the end, he got his coat back. You say, how does this happen? How does somebody go from slave to deputy Pharaoh? It's because God's writing this story. That's how it happens. And God wants to populate a nation. So what does he do? He goes to an elderly and fertile couple, and he says, I want you to populate the nation. Now the time has come for God to rescue his people. And so what does he do? The famine is coming. Who does he put in a position of authority and power? A former slave, an ex-con, Joseph, who has been faithful. So Joseph oversees the nation, and he sees Egypt through the time of famine, but not only Egypt, but the outlying countries that are around, where Joseph's lousy brothers live. And now they head down to Egypt because they hear that someone in Egypt was wise enough to prepare for the famine. Don't you love this? 2 years into the famine, the brothers, who are from a wealthy family, who have money, they just don't have food, they show up in front of the vice president of Egypt, and they don't recognize Joseph. You know, he probably had the eyeliner thing going on now. He was 17 when they sold him as a slave. He's 39 years old now. And do you know what they did when they came before the vice president of Egypt? They bow down. Oh. Don't you wonder if Joseph's going, these guys look familiar. Let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Then it hits him, oh. But he keeps his poker face. Doesn't let on that he knows who they are. And he asks, why have you come here? And they explain, and Joseph toys with them a little bit. And there's some pages of different tests that he puts them through and puts a silver cup in Benjamin's sack in order to help bring their father back. And eventually there's this moment where Joseph finally lets his brothers know, guys, it's me. Maybe he wipes his eyeliner off or something like that. It's me. And do you know what they did? Home Alone. They're like freaking out. Why? I mean, Joseph says, guys, why are you scared? Oh, maybe because we beat you up and threw you in a cistern and sold you to some slaves 20 years ago and ruined your life and lied to our father. And the last time we saw you was from the bottom of that cistern. And now all you have to do is say, guards, and we're dead. But he calls his brothers close. And he says, I am your brother, Joseph, the one you sold into Egypt. Don't be afraid. Don't be stressed out, because it was to save many lives that God sent me ahead of you. Now, this is the coolest part of the story, going through the story like we are, because you see things that connect in this overarching look that you don't see when you're just looking at isolated passages of Scripture. Remember God promising Abraham last week, say, I'm going to make you a blessing and all the nations of the earth will be blessed through your seed. Here it is. We're just at Abraham's great-grandson, and already all the nations of the earth are being blessed through the seed of Abraham because he's able to feed the earth at a time of famine. You see, Joseph understood this was all part of God's story that he was writing. Yes, it was difficult, and yes, it was challenging stuff that was going on in his lower story, in his circumstances, but in the upper story that God was writing, I mean, that involves saving the world. Now turn over to the last page of this chapter, page 42. In the second paragraph, Joseph, years later, is speaking to his brothers about their past, about all they've been through, and these brothers are still feeling guilty about what they had done, and so he tries to give them some perspective on it. And he says, you intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. You intended it for harm, but God intended it for good. You intended it for evil, but God intended it for greater purposes. You meant it to get rid of me, but God meant it to put me in a position to feed you and the world someday. Now, the great question that all of us have when we're in the channel of adversity is this: where is God? Where is God in the midst of this lower story that I'm in? Where is God in your disappointment? Where is God when, you know, things aren't working out like you planned? Where is God? Here's the funny thing. The Bible says no less than 3 times that when other people looked at Joseph and they're watching him go through these circumstances in his lower story, other people say, wow, God is with him. Isn't that interesting? When Joseph was sold to Potiphar, the Bible says, and the Lord was with him. When Joseph went to prison because of the false accusations, the Bible says, the Lord was with him. In the prison, the warden put Joseph in charge of all those in the prison because he saw something, because the Lord was with Joseph. Over and over again, we read that the Lord was with him. And let me tell you something. When you're hurting, when you're disappointed, when you're wounded, when you're tired, when you're down in the pit, when you're in the channel of adversity, God is with you. And when you realize God is with you, and when you realize that God is up to something, maybe that you can't see right now, God is going to make something happen. Joseph even said, what you intended for harm, God intended for good. He works all things together for good for those who love him. So here's the big idea of chapter 3, and I waited till the very end to share it with you. Disappointment is never the last word in any story God writes. Never. It's never the last word in any story God's writing, and it's not going to be the last word in your story. And if you choose by faith to trust God in your channel of adversity, it's not going to be the last word in your story. Even though right now he seems silent, even though right now you can't see him, even though right now you don't know what he's up to. You know, when you came in today, you were given one of these beautiful cards with this picture on it. In fact, if you didn't get one of these, I'd love for you to have one. And I'm going to ask you just to raise your hand, and we got some people. They'll bring you one if you need one. I mean, if anybody needs one, just keep it up. There's going to be some people in the aisles, and they'll just find you, okay? So keep it up. And then also near you, there's some cups in the cup holders that have some pens in it. I'd like everybody to get something to write with, a pen or a pencil. This is just for you. It's not anything you're going to turn in, so you don't have to worry about that. But I'd like for you to have something to write with. And let me tell you a little bit about this picture. One of the things that we're doing throughout the story is we have so many great artists here at Eastside, and they're creating an art gallery. And they're creating a piece of art for each chapter through the story. So if you go out into the lobby today, you can see the first three pieces of art from the first three chapters of the story. And so by the time we get done with this journey, we'll have 31 pieces of art. And this was the piece of art that was created for the story of Joseph. It's done by an artist in our church named Susanna Bond. And there's so much that the more you look at this picture, the more you're going to see than just a, you know, kind of a sad face looking guy who's got some eyeliner on. You notice his beautiful coat that started off early in his life that his father gave him, that beautiful, colorful coat. And then on the other side, you'll see he's wearing the garb of the Egyptians. You see that in this picture, there's light and there's darkness. You see that there's a time of harvest on one side. There's a time of prosperity, and then there's a time of famine. Off in the distance, you can see his brothers, who had no idea that the one who went ahead of them was eventually going to save his life. There's just so much in here. 12 stars. Just, I could go on and on. You know, some of you here today, you're in a time of prosperity in your life. And when you're in a time of prosperity, you need to thank God for it, because we all know times of prosperity don't last forever. We saw that a few years ago when the economy took a dive. We thought, you know, housing prices were just going to keep going up and up and up and up forever. We're always going to be employed forever. And housing prices did this, and many of you went through corporate cutbacks and job transitions and furloughs. And you know, things don't last like that forever. So if this is a time of prosperity in your life, say, oh man, the family's healthy, the kids are healthy, mom and dad are healthy. You know, we got food on the table, nice roof over our head. The Bible says every good and perfect gift comes from the Father above. And you need to thank God today. And I would encourage you, with your pen or pencil, maybe use the backside of that card just to begin a note to God that says, God, I thank you for. God, I thank you for. And just tell him and acknowledge it. Some of you, you have your own business. You have your own company. It's doing better than it's ever done before. Just thank God for that. I thank you for. Others of you today, you're in a time of adversity, and you're in the channel, and it's a season of disappointment. And it's very challenging for you. And maybe today you need to say, God, I trust you that one day you're going to redeem this situation. Because that's what God does. He is the great redeemer. He works things all together for good. Friends, never give up on God. Never give up on God redeeming your story, because he is the great redeemer. This is one of the greatest things that I love about God. He can redeem anything. It's never too broken. It's never too late. It's never too busted. He can take all the broken pieces and he can turn them into something beautiful. Your pain is not going to last forever, but you're going to last forever. And what is coming one day, whether it's in this life or in the other side in heaven, it's going to all make sense of what's happening right now. Let God finish his work in you. This is the upper story of the Bible that God is telling us. So maybe today, some of you who are in this season of adversity need to begin to write out a prayer that just says, God, I will trust you for, or I will trust you during. And take a few moments and just be specific about the lower story that's going on in your life that's pretty tough right now. And make a statement that you're going to trust him through this time. So we'll give you a few moments to do this while Joel and the team just play some beautiful music.